Thomas, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. Whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many.
Hello everyone, Sidney St. James. Today is going to be a fun broadcast, and one where I go back a decade and cover some of my best-selling novels, and how each one has a dramatic scene that I could never have written without the help of music. And not just any music, special songs that brought out the inspiration that I needed to finish off the series. About 5 years ago, Amazon sent an invitation to write a screenplay for one of my novels called Faith, 70x7. Well, the truth of the matter is, I'm on my fourth pass of writing it. It is actually far more difficult to write than one of my stories. In Faith, a 365-page novel, it was important that I write the screenplay in under 100 pages. Much easier, my friend, said than done. Writing a scene in one of my novels, which is usually one of the last scenes that the entire book worked up to, required my finding a song. And sitting here and closing my eyes and playing that song and listening to the words that began to come out of my mind. Kind of like that in watching any love story that brings water to your eyes. Just like the TV series, if you've ever watched it, called Signed, Sealed, and Delivered. If you haven't, watch one of those episodes. And to be honest, tell me. Tell me you don't get a tear in your eye at the very end. So today, I will share my secret song for how I got the inspiration for each one of my three best-selling novels. So, again, everyone, thanks for joining me today, and I hope you enjoy Season 4, Episode 4 of the Sidney St. James Show. Well, welcome everyone to my first novel called Faith, 70x7. Then came Peter to him, and he said, Lord, how oft shall my brother sin against me, and I forgive him? Till 7 times? Jesus said to him, I say not unto thee, until 7 times, but until 70x7. Reverend Lois Estes, with the Cumberland Presbyterian Church at the funeral services on December 23rd, 1969, addressed the congregation. The dignified First Lady of the Louisiana Presbytery is dead. Vibrantly alive are the articles of faith that constitute our legacy. May her mantle fall on us prayerfully. Reverend Ada Caston Slayton Bonds is one of the most colorful ministers ever produced by the great Cumberland Presbyterian Church. Beyond any doubt, she overcame more difficulties and passed through more heartaches than any minister ever known to preach the whosoever will gospel. Miss Ada, as all affectionately called her, possessed countless prodigies. Through the quarters of her ministerial career, she helped shape the lives and mold the character of many, many young ministers who today still rise up and call her blessed. God sent her His divine calling to preach, and then she then learned to preach, and she carved out a unique place for herself among the clergy without any comparison. With bottomless emotion, genuine poise, and true dignity, Miss Ada became the first lady of the cloth in the Louisiana Presbytery and had the highest honor bestowed upon her, the mother of all presbyteries title. Brother Cairns finished his Sunday morning services by calling on Reverend Paul Covey Johnson, standing by her frail and physical body, awaiting its final resting place in the old Bethany Cumberland Presbyterian Church Cemetery just outside of Coushatta, Louisiana. He began her final epitaph. I'm walking along the seashore. A ship is floating near me, spreading her white sails as it begins a voyage that takes Miss Ada further and further out into the ocean. She's a powerful vessel, one of beauty and strength. I watch her until she looks like a disappearing speck of a fluffy cloud, where the sea and the sky's horizon intermingle with one another. Then, I realized her diminished size was in me and not in her. Look, he said, there, she's gone. Nessa and Ada's brother Lilburn are standing together with eager eyes, watching from one of the 12 gates to heaven. There are beautiful angels stationed at each of the entrances. And looking more closely, she sees her mother and father standing near Lilburn. There are smiles on their faces and a happy and content look to their demeanor, standing and waiting to take up the welcome shout. Here she comes. Throughout her memoirs, I often discussed Ada's unlimited ability to find forgiveness with my wife, Barbara. She and I discussed this many times. I finally came to grips for the very first time with answers to questions about her continuing to remain in such an abusive marriage. I came to respect her inner strength, her compassion, and her gentleness. Never, never once in my life have I delved so many times into the scriptures and analyzed what each meant more so than when I put her memoirs down on paper. To bring these memoirs to a close, I attended the homecoming services at Progress Cumberland Presbyterian Church in Pleasant Hill, Louisiana, as they celebrated its 100th anniversary. Miss Ada is still spoken of highly and sets the goal high for preaching the Word of God. Her last letter, written to the church on December 10th, 1969, still hangs on the sanctuary walls. Brother Lawson led the congregation in the singing of many gospel tunes that day and delivered the Sunday morning message. I close this description with a quote from Brother Lawson. Miss Ada set high standards for being a minister in the Cumberland Presbyterian Church. She was an anomaly for her time. Still today, we find the bar for preaching the Word of God set high for all young men and women entering the ministry. If one listened real close, they would have heard the words echo from my namesake, my mother Dorothy's brother, Sidney Slayton, when he said, "Mama was a preacher." I needed to have something I could listen to over and over to write the final epitaph of the movie for one of the most loved people in all of North Louisiana. I chose a song that in her memoirs she was her favorite. She learned it from all the cotton pickers in 1903 as they sang, headed down to Red River Parish near the Red River to pick cotton. And each year, Miss Ada and her congregation would sing it at Easter, and they would sing it at Christmas. That song, my friends, gave me the inspiration and the strength to write the conclusion to Faith 70 times 7.
In my heart.
Well, now on to our next novel, or should I say novels, part one and two of I Am Woman. Took a very long time to write, probably for me over 9 months, but it was near the end of 800 pages in book two that I stopped. And once again, I sat here at my desk and I closed my eyes. It was as though I was in a movie theater and I needed a song that would once again bring the same emotion out in the reader as it does for me, the writer. And I found just that song. I decided to take four beautiful young women, known throughout the novel as the Four Musketeers, who pledged a lifelong friendship with each other before the beginning of the Civil War, and follow their lives of falling in love after graduation from the Hampton Women's College. Unfortunately, they signed their life away to become a slave to their husbands based on our country's laws in the 1860s. Frances Fran Meyer, Jackie Bonzo Hager, and Debbie Deb Kiner all fall in love only to find out the man they loved was a traitor and fought for the Confederate forces. The fourth musketeer, Diane Jenkins, has a lifelong secret she never reveals and has an extreme dislike for men. Although a strong word, some might even say she hated men. Then, Frances Meyer, who defects from the red, white, and blue, goes with her husband to fight for the South. Bonzo Hager is drafted by the Army of the Potomac and laughed at when she arrives to muster. She then asks her father to subsidize a substitute to fight for her. Then, there's Debbie Kiner, the daughter of a Lutheran minister. She gives her heart and soul as a sister of mercy in the hospitals for many soldiers injured and killed in the war, both the rebels and the Yankees. She also gives up her love for a man who left to fight under Robert E. Lee and the Southern forces of the Confederacy. As sunlight enters raindrops, so love enters the souls of these young women and emerges as their passions in state rights and women's rights. It is how they find their truth and purpose in life. It's how the Four Musketeers gives themselves to others. Throughout this story, they each discover that it's love that makes them who they are and how powerful forgiveness can be in their lives. Rights for women in the 1860s were withdrawn when she married. In general, women gave up so much property and civil rights when they said, "I do," that it was said they entered a state of civil death. In 1860, women were trapped in their homes and performed domestic chores and duties. Their role as a housewife was to bear children and to bear them as long as possible. Also, to care for the children while submitting to their husband's every whim. It was prevalent for a family to have as many as 12 or up to 14 children in the 1800s. Women are already born so far ahead ability-wise. The day that men can give birth, that's when we can start talking about equal rights. In my novel, there was one intense battle towards the end of part two. I found just the song that I needed to play over and over again, and I closed my eyes, and I wanted to bring so much emotion in the final climactic part of my novel, and I wanted to write it just right. And one of those songs did the trick. And the scene, me as the writer, well, it brought tears to my eyes. It is an emotional part of the two-part series. But again, no spoiler alerts, but I will play the song that gave me the inspiration for that last scene in that novel. Well, we're back to talk about our third and last novel. But before we do, I'd like you to hear a few words from my sponsor. After all, they're the ones that help me keep my lights on around this place. So we'll be right back with the rest and ending of my story. Have you heard about Anchor.fm by Spotify? It's the easiest way to make a podcast with everything you need all in one place. Yep, Anchor has the tools that will allow you to record
and edit your podcast right from your phone or your computer. And best of all, Anchor is totally free. Download the Anchor app or go to anchor.fm to get started.
Well, we're back now with the rest of my story. Back about 5 or 6 years ago, when I was writing my very first romance novel, it ended up being 3 books. It was called the Storm Lord Trilogy. That's right. And it was my first shot at doing a real romance with lots of steam, lots of excitement, and lots of suspense. And using the rich background of the spiritual world of Archangels Michael and his sword of angels and Gabriel with his trumpet of victory as the background, I wrote the Storm Lords Trilogy series. Pursues the return of Satan himself with a paranormal bent world of evil versus good, filled with absolutely fascinating characters. The ever-moving series' sharp dialogue, its highly original plot lines, and stylistic flair are as rhythmic and vibrant as all of my earlier works combined. Through my imagination, waking up at night with bad dreams or scary dreams and jumping on my laptop and starting to write the novels, this happened so regularly when I got to writing them. These 3 novels in the Storm Lord Trilogy series are provocative. They're confrontational and contain highly ingenious twists and turn into the unexpected. But always, always with a healthy dose of humor, not to mention romance, no matter how intense the circumstances might become. I think my imagination got away from me a little bit and was unbound and improvised, leaving reality and touching the sky and returning, often with a lots of descriptive style, will leave you, the reader, on the edge of your seat. In my final chapter, Angie Connors must find the 3 keys to Armageddon, or all hell will break loose, literally. Every expertly written quest pits our heroine against evil, out to destroy the goodness in the world. Along with her mother, Angelica Thompson, Nikki is propelled into challenges in which they could die at every single turn. Action on their part is required. Every step, every single step of the way to keep the world good and in balance and with peace. This novel was my first attempt, as I told you, at romance, and my first attempt at writing a paranormal romance. When I was writing the 3rd novel in the series, again, I needed to blow people's socks off. Something intense. And I found, again, just the right song for it. And as you as a reader can only tell if I pulled it off by reading the series. This series, my friend, will find you clapping rather than crying at the end. Or, is it the other way around? Sorry, no spoiler alerts here. But the song that gave me the inspiration is right around the corner.
In this time of desperation, all we know is doubt and fear. foundation. We believe. We believe. In this broken generation, when all is dark, you help us see. There is only one salvation. Christ, we believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. We believe. So let our faith be more than anthems, greater than the songs we sing. And in our weakness and temptations,
Well, that does it for me for another great episode from Sidney St. James. Be sure to click on the tab above that says send a voice message, and I will get it from you, and I'll probably play it back on one of my future podcasts. Also, don't forget to click the button follow. I'd love for you to follow my podcast. But it's been fun. I hope you enjoyed this episode. And until next time, here I am, Sidney St. James. Happy listening.